talking about food, you know. We have a special guest today. Her name is Brianne Pritchard Yates, and she's a nutritionist. She's going to tell you a little more about herself before she begins her presentation, but she's going to talk to you today about meal planning, all right? What you should eat, portions, and all of that, okay? So, Brianne, you can come right now. All of our clients here are type 2, so you don't have any type 1s that they expect. One of our type 1s to come in, but they're all type 2s. So please welcome Mrs. Brianne.
To do, how to do it, what some of these things mean that you hear over and over again. So hopefully we can go through and clarify some things and give you a better idea of how to manage your blood sugar through your food and through your meal planning. So just to give you a little bit of background, I studied exercise science, LA Health in school. From there I started working in the medical field and seeing a lot of chronic issues coming up over and over again, working in the emergency room. Oftentimes it was uncontrolled blood pressure, oftentimes uncontrolled blood sugar that were leading to more severe issues. And it was talking about, you know, take this medication and that was it. There wasn't much being talked about lifestyle changes, what you could do to actually be healthier, and how to manage some of these conditions just through lifestyle changes. So I decided to go back to school, study nutrition, and that's kind of how it's led me here. So I like the combination of exercise and nutrition, but today we're focusing just on nutrition. So if you have any questions as we go through, if you're not sure what anything means or you just have questions, please ask. The more interactive, the more you take away from it. So don't be afraid to ask anything. There are no bad questions. So we'll get started. So just we'll do a quick review about the types of diabetes. You already are probably familiar with these, but we'll just kind of do a quick review. The relationship between food and blood glucose, so how the food you're eating actually affects your blood glucose or your blood sugar. We'll talk about the food groups and the guidelines and how to make sure that your diet is fitting into this guideline. We'll talk a bit about food labels because it's so important to know what we're consuming. And planning meals so that you can have a good variety of foods and the right amount. And then give you some meal ideas and some examples that you can actually put into practice. So we're just going to do a quick review of the types of diabetes. So of course we have pre-diabetes. This is a borderline high blood glucose level. Maybe some of you have been told this, or maybe that's your current situation where your blood sugar is borderline high. You want to be careful if it goes much higher. This is at risk for developing or becoming type 2 diabetic, right? Type 1 is a different type. Is everyone kind of familiar with type 1 versus type 2? So type 1 is often called or referred to as insulin dependent because their bodies are not producing any insulin. So that's when you have to, you know, give the injection of insulin. Type 2 is different. This is the majority of cases. This is 90 to 95% of all cases of diabetes is type 2. This is what you're all familiar with, right? Where diet really comes into play because your body's producing insulin, but just at, you know, a lower rate, or maybe your bodies aren't totally receiving the insulin that your body's producing. So that's where the diet really comes into play, and making sure that you're controlling how much sugar you're intaking because it can build up in the bloodstream. So everyone's familiar with this, right? You see the symptoms. Increased thirst, frequent urination, increased hunger, all of these. Has anyone experienced any of these symptoms at some point?
Yeah.
Increases those dark areas. think that you've all already seen the video, is that right? Where it does a breakdown of diabetes and how the blood sugar builds up in the bloodstream based on the foods that you eat.
The video is attached to that link.
It is, I can play it.
Then I'll definitely take a picture of it.
I actually have it up and ready to go. So it's short, but it's in.
People with diabetes can live long, healthy lives. Sure. Let's go over some basics. This is diabetes. It's simple. When we eat, food travels to the sun. Food is made up of three basic nutrients: carbohydrates, proteins, and fats. During digestion, carbohydrates are broken down into sugar, otherwise known as glucose. Here's a quick fact. Carbohydrates include foods such as bread, rice, pasta, potatoes, fruit, milk, and yogurt. In a normal digestive process, sugar travels from the stomach, through the bloodstream, to your body's muscle and fat cells. However, sugar can't enter these cells without the help of a special hormone called insulin, which is produced by the pancreas. Insulin acts like a key, unlocking the doors to the muscle and fat cells and allowing the sugar to enter. The cells then use the sugar as fuel to provide energy for the body. When this process is functioning properly, sugar entering the bloodstream from the stomach is able to exit the bloodstream at the muscle and fat cells. In this manner, the body is able to regulate the concentration of sugar in the bloodstream. Now let's see what happens in a person with diabetes. Sugar enters the bloodstream, but one of two things happens. Either the pancreas does not produce a sufficient quantity of insulin to match the sugar entering the bloodstream, or the body's cells do not respond to the insulin that the body is producing. In both cases, the result is the same. Cell doors remain closed, causing sugar to get backed up in the bloodstream. As a result, blood sugar levels rise. This creates several problems. Because sugars are not able to enter your body's cells, your body is not getting the fuel it needs. As a result, you may feel tired or fatigued. Your body may try to dilute the excess sugar in the bloodstream by pulling fluid out of your cells. This can leave you feeling dehydrated and thirsty. Most importantly, over time, exposure to high blood sugar levels can cause damage to vital organs connected to the bloodstream, such as your eyes, kidneys, nerves, and heart. If not controlled properly, diabetes can lead to serious complications, such as blindness, amputation, kidney failure, heart attack, and stroke. In order to avoid these complications, people with diabetes must take steps to keep their blood sugar levels in a normal range. One way to do this is through diet. By reducing the amount of carbohydrates you eat in a single meal or snack, you can regulate the amount of sugar entering the bloodstream and prevent your body's insulin supply from becoming overwhelmed. This may mean limiting high sugar foods such as cake, pie, candy, and soda. You know which ones. Another way to regulate blood sugar is through exercise. Physical activity makes your body's muscle and fat cells more receptive to insulin. In other words, those muscle and fat cells that wouldn't open before, now they will. Finally, your doctor may prescribe oral medications to increase your supply of insulin, regulate the amount of sugar entering the bloodstream, or make your body's cells more receptive to the insulin your body is producing. In some cases, insulin shots may also be necessary. Okay, let's review. We've talked about what diabetes is, a condition where either the body does not produce enough insulin, or the body's cells are not receptive to the insulin being produced. We've seen what complications can arise from it, such as fatigue, dehydration, and damage to vital organs. Finally, we've discussed ways to manage it through diet, exercise, and medication. For more information about your specific health diagnosis and treatment plan, please talk to your doctor.
Good video. learn something that they didn't know before. I like that one because it breaks it down very easy to understand and it gives you the visual of how it's actually working in your body. So, how does food affect blood sugar levels? The video extended a bit, but we'll go one more in. So, everything you eat is broken down into various parts, right? Does anyone know what these different parts are? It did say it, but we'll review.
Carbohydrates.
Fats.
Protein.
And protein. Good. So those are your macronutrients. Those are the, you know, the biggest parts, those three. And it's what you break down. And not, foods are not just one or the other. They're oftentimes combinations of those. So if you have a piece of chicken, for example, it's going to be protein, but also fat. If you're having nuts, protein, a little bit of carbohydrates and fats as well, right? So foods are not just one or the other, it's a combination of. So we have to understand that when we eat something, it's broken down into those various parts, and then that's what our bodies use to help us function. Then we have our micronutrients. Has anyone heard this term before? Those are the smaller parts. Those are the vitamins, minerals, everything else that's broken down and used for your bodies to function. So very important to have those micronutrients as well as the macronutrients. The micronutrients, when you hear people talk about, and we'll mention it in a minute, but have you ever heard of nutrient-dense foods? Have you heard someone say, choose foods that are nutrient-dense? No? Okay, well, when you hear that term, all it means is choosing foods that have not just the macronutrients, the carbohydrates, the fats, and the proteins, but also a lot of micronutrients, those vitamins and minerals that are very good for us. So in type 2 diabetes, carbohydrates are the focus, right? Everyone's familiar with knowing how many carbohydrates you have, because those are what convert to glucose or sugar in the bloodstream. So that's what the focus is on when we're talking about a diet. Again, these carbohydrates break down, like you saw in the video, into blood sugar. So of course, the more carbohydrates that you have in your diet, the higher levels of sugar you'll have in your blood. So if you can imagine drinking a Coke, right? Lots of sugar, it's in liquid form, you drink it, where does it go?
Straight into the bloodstream.
Into the bloodstream, right. And if we have a hard time, our body has a hard time removing that sugar from the bloodstream, but it builds up, and that's where you could get very high blood sugar. So everyone knows this, the more carbohydrates you have, the higher your blood sugar is likely to go. Then we'll talk about different kinds of carbohydrates. Has anyone heard that there are good carbs versus bad carbs?
Yeah.
Right. This is just a simple way of breaking it down into simple carbohydrates versus complex carbohydrates. So your simple carbohydrates are made up of one or two sugar molecules. So small. When they're broken down, it happens very quickly. So you get a quick boost of energy, but also boost of blood sugar. So a good example of this would be, let's say, what's a good example? Let's say a white piece of bread, or maybe a cup of white rice, something like that, that's made of simple carbohydrates that break down very quickly. Examples here, also table sugar, of course we know, brown sugar, honey, sodas, candy, fruit drinks, those sorts of things are broken down very quickly because they're only made up of those one or two sugar molecules. Versus complex carbohydrates. These are more of a long strain of molecules linked together, so the body breaks them down a bit slower. They're often rich in fiber. Those can be plant foods, which are also great because they have lots of those micronutrients, those vitamins and minerals. Examples would be oatmeal, green vegetables like your spinach or kale, lettuce even, whole grain breads and pastas, beans as well. Okay, so those are going to be your complex carbohydrates. Those break down a bit slower, giving you more control over your blood sugar. You're not going to get that spike in blood sugar like you would with the simple carbohydrates. Does that make sense? That's why when you hear people talk about, and we'll mention it too, but a whole grain piece of bread versus a white piece of bread, or brown rice versus white rice, things like that, that's the difference in those, the makeup, the chemical makeup of those foods.
So, pastas.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Does it get complexity?
If they're whole grain pastas.
All grain.
Yes. So the, again, the white pastas are going to be more on the simple carbohydrate end, so they'll break down quicker versus the complex, right, the whole wheat, because they have more fiber breaking down slower. So if your body's having a hard time removing those sugars, we want to have them break down at a slower rate versus all at once. Does that help? So what are carbohydrates? Carbohydrates are broken down into a few different categories, and if anyone is already in the process or in the habit of checking those food nutrition facts on their foods, you'll see that you'll have your total carbohydrate, and then it's broken down into different parts. Those different parts being sugars, starch, and fiber. So when you look at, again, we're going to cover the food labels, but I'll mention it more than the total carbohydrate is all of these combined. So again, here are some carbohydrate examples. Can everyone up here tell, give me, which ones of those are your simple carbohydrates?
Sugar.
Yeah, absolutely. What else?
Potatoes,
yes.
Corn.
White potatoes.
Corn.
Not food.
Corn.
Corn. Juice. Juice is a good one.
Snack food, sweets.
Yes, so that's great. Those are your simple carbohydrates. Those are the ones that break down faster, right? Of course, the pasta, the cereals, some of those you can get both. You can have it, choose a simple carbohydrate version or a more complex carbohydrate. So something that has more fiber in it, something that's more whole grain, and we'll talk about cereals too, because those are tricky. Because you think, oh, these are great, they're, you know, the box says that they're really healthy for my heart and all of that, and then you realize how much sugar is in a bowl of that. And then it surprises you, especially anything with the dried fruit, like the raisin bran and the tricky. But yes, good point. Cereals are one of those. So carb counting. Is anyone familiar with this method of tracking? Does anyone do it? Not really?
I do.
You do? Okay. Yeah, we'll go through and we'll look at that, but it's good that you're familiar with this and some of you are kind of doing it. That's great. So, carbohydrate counting. The general rule is 30 to 60 grams of carbohydrates per meal. Okay? So we're talking about your breakfast, your lunch, your dinner. That's the general guideline is between 30 and 60. Usually I like to fall straight in the middle when I'm telling people. So around 45 grams of carbohydrates is where I like to stay, because if we're aiming for 60, it's very easy to go over that. So if you aim kind of middle of the road, it's a bit safer. And then 15 to 30 grams of carbohydrates for a snack. And again, these are numbers. Who has a really good understanding of what 30 to 60 grams of carbohydrates means? Good. We'll break that down too, just to give you an understanding of what these numbers mean. Because a lot of times it just 15 grams of carbohydrates for my snack. Okay, but what does that actually look like when we're talking about snacks? So that's what we'll go through and kind of break it down and give you some visuals. So here we go. 15 grams is considered one serving. So just to give you that idea, 15 grams of carbohydrates, so this is going to be, you know, maybe a snack or maybe it's part of your meal, but that's one small piece of fresh fruit, a half a cup of canned or frozen fruit, one slice of bread, a third cup of cooked rice or pasta, right? Cooked being a key word there. One third of uncooked rice is much different from one third cup of cooked rice. Four to six crackers, depending, of course, all of this is depending on what kind you're having, the brand, all of that. But generally, 4 to 6 crackers, like maybe Ritz crackers, something like that, about 15 grams of carbohydrates. A half of an English muffin or half of a hamburger bun is 15. So if you're having a hamburger and you're having the top and bottom bun, you're at your 30 grams of carbohydrates. So if we're aiming for 45 grams for that meal, you know, if we're having it with some french fries, you're way over. Maybe you're having it with something that's also very high carbohydrate, it's going to could easily put you over that limit.
We would have went to garden bread with a salad.
That's much better, right? Because the salad, and again, depending on some other factors, like what else is in the salad, what the dressing is on the salad, those things, but that would be a much better option than getting fries, right? So, does that make sense? You have to combine everything in the meal. Also, half a cup of black beans or starchy vegetable is considered one serving.
Mm-hmm.
A quarter of a large baked potato. 2/3 cup of plain fat-free yogurt or 6 chicken nuggets. Okay, because
so
of the breading on there.
Yeah, the chicken nuggets,
yeah.
That is slimy sometimes. I need to go buy the fat
food.
Well,
here's
one.
And a lot of, I put that on there because a lot of times for having a meat, right, a chicken, maybe it's a fried piece of chicken, you're thinking it's just protein, but it's not just protein because it's breaded and fried. So you're going to have carbohydrates in that too. Yeah.
Unsaturated fats.
And saturated fats. Exactly. Yeah. But if you were just to have a piece of a chicken breast, no carbohydrates in that, right? Because it's not breaded.
Nothing
is fine.
Right.
And not too much fat.
Right.
Yeah. Good. So what is healthy eating? You know, it's such a common term. Eat healthy, healthy eating, but what does it actually mean? So I want to break it down. Healthy eating includes eating a wide variety of all foods. Okay, we can't just live off of protein. We can't just live off of fats or just off of carbohydrates. We need a combination of all of these foods. So really making sure to choose a variety, healthy variety, and we'll go into that. Eating a balanced diet will ensure that you get all of the nutrients that your body needs to function. It's not just satisfying that craving or you're hungry so you eat. Eating serves a purpose. The sole purpose of eating is to fuel our bodies to make them work the best they can. So choosing the foods that are going to help you is very important. Again, being cautious about your carbohydrate and your sugar intake will help stabilize your blood sugar levels. Any questions with that? And it's not, a lot of times people think, well, it's two things. Over time, we've gotten used to eating more, right? Excuse me. Over time, portion sizes have just gotten bigger and bigger. So one is kind of retraining ourselves to know what we should actually be eating at once, but also not eating too little. A lot of times people, you know, start changing their diet and they realize that their portion sizes have been too big over time, but then sometimes they go to the extreme and start having too little. So we need to find something right in the middle that's giving you everything you need, but not too much. So the five food groups. There are pictures of it everywhere, but can anyone say the five of all of them?
This is the first time that I've ever actually read the label on something like that.
Yes. You're on the right track. We'll start with the most obvious one, I hope. What's next?
Poultry.
Meat.
Grains.
Meat.
Protein. Meat. Which a lot of times people just think
dairy.
Of as meat. Dairy. Right. So, then we'll pull up the picture that I'm sure most of you have seen at some point. Those are your five food groups. So, making sure to get a good combination of foods from all of those food groups is very important. Let's see, I don't want to go too much into it. So, choosing your foods, choosing your vegetables. So, vegetables are filled with nutrients, those micronutrients that we talked about, the vitamins and minerals that are very important. So, the more vegetables, the better. Choosing a variety of colors and textures. So, this is something that I like to recommend. If we're used to eating vegetables, or maybe it's something we're starting to introduce, we typically start to eat the same ones over and over again, right? Which is great. I'm very happy that you're eating your vegetables, but at the same time, you're getting those same nutrients over and over again. So the more variety, the more colors, the more textures, the more vitamins and minerals you're going to get from those foods. Okay, so variety is key with your vegetables. Fresh veggies. Raw, lightly steamed, or roasted are the best way to have them because it preserves most of the nutrients that are in those foods. spinach and arugula are really great options because they're very high in nutrients. And there are ways to incorporate these into the diet. If you're not a huge fan of kale, don't worry, you can kind of keep incorporated in some other ways where you don't necessarily know that you're feeling it. Low sodium or unsalted canned vegetables can be an option as well. Of course, fresh is going to be the best option, not always available. So frozen would be a second, and then canned would kind of be your third best option, but still an option. Being sure to limit those starchy vegetables though. So for the most part, vegetables are free grain, the more the better, with the exception of a few, which some of you already know, the corn, baked potatoes, and peas, right? Those, not to say you can have them, but just be cautious of how much you're having at once, because they do have an effect on your blood sugar. Fruits. Fresh fruit is a great option. Do you have any love fruit?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah? Okay. Depends on the
fruit. When it comes to the food, are there any that you want to stay away from?
There are some that are better options, because fruit, as we know, is high, it does have natural sugar in it. But at the end of the day, when it's broken down, it still converts to glucose in the bloodstream. So there are some that are better options than others, and we'll talk about that. Plain frozen fruit or fruit canned without sugar being the key. And also trying to avoid fruit drinks, jams and jellies, those sorts of things. Even though they're fruit, oftentimes there's lots of sugar added to them, which can be kind of surprising when you put, you know, some jam on your toast or whatever it is. You're not realizing how much sugar you're actually getting in that.
Peanut butter?
Yeah. Depending on which one, it can be okay, and you can have it in moderation, but some of them do have added sugars in there, so you just have to be cautious. Fruit drinks, though, you know, everyone's thinking fruit drink, it must be good because it's made of fruit. But a lot of times there's tons of sugar in there, right? Especially if you're drinking it with a meal that has lots of carbohydrates in there. Most likely afterwards your blood sugar is going to go very high. Okay, so just be cautious, check the label. Your protein. Everyone thinks of meat when we talk about protein, but that's also your fish, seafood, eggs, and other dairy. And then also beans, nuts, and seeds are all part of the protein category. Being sure to limit your meats that are high in those saturated fats or those trans fats. The saturated fats, so I like to explain it, saturated fats are solid at room temperature. Okay, so if you think about kind of fatty steak, right? There's a visible layer of fat there. Yeah. That would be your saturated fat. We think about butter, right? When it's sitting out on the counter, it's not too hot, it's pretty solid, right? Versus something like olive oil that's liquid, completely liquid at room temperature. That's going to be an unsaturated fat, right? So that's a good way to tell the difference between a saturated versus an unsaturated fat. The unsaturated fats actually have healthy benefits. The saturated fats we want to keep to a minimum. Okay. Fried foods are also something that's very high in saturated fats.
What about conquered also?
So they do
iron cholesterol,
right. So the jury's kind of still out on whether dietary cholesterol immediately affects your blood cholesterol. So what I tell people with that, because fish, seafood is a great option, and we have so much of it here, that we can, it's a good part of your diet to incorporate, but just not do it all the time, right? Yeah. Everything in moderation. Dairy, that's going to be your milk, your yogurt, your cheese, sour cream even. Dairy has a place, right? Does anyone like dairy?
Yeah.
But just being sure.
So just saying cheese.
It's just part of the dairy category. It's not bad.
She's excited right now.
You like cheese?
No, I don't.
Oh, okay, you already asked.
Okay. Yeah, and this is just going through to break down what foods go into all of the five food groups. So. And then we have our fats and healthy oils. So again, this is where he talks about this unsaturated versus saturated fats. Your unsaturated fats are going to be your healthy fats. So those are foods like olive oil, coconut oil is kind of a mixture of the two. Canola oil, salmon, tuna, those cold water fish are going to give you lots of those healthy unsaturated fats. Has anyone heard about omega-3s? Omega-3s are good for heart health, right? All of that. Those are going to be your healthy fats that are in those fish. Usually I go with the water option. But again, if it's not something you're doing every day, it can be okay to have it in the olive oil. But if you're doing it on a regular basis, I would go with the water. And then because likely are you making a tuna salad out of it, something like that. So if you're putting mayo in there, you're going to get fats as well. So if that's the case, I would go with the lesser fat because you're going to be adding some of that.
What about the omega-3 tablets?
Those are beneficial for sure. Especially if you're not eating, you know, tuna or salmon all the time. Especially those fresh tuna and fresh salmon. This omega-3 supplements are beneficial.
So I've heard it's the three oils that you even some people even use the W's to talk about.
There are so many different.
But I'm talking about it. Someone said that if you use it to fry, it'll be okay. But someone made me understand that if you heat the oil to a certain temperature, it destroys the nutrients in the oil, then it becomes saturated. It almost behaves like a saturated fat.
It behaves like a saturated fat, right? So being careful to not heat these oils to a very high temperature, and all of them act a bit differently. But there are some that are better for, you know, like olive oil is great on your salad. That's as a dressing. You know, when it's heated, it can change a bit. So the chemical makeup of these oils can change depending on the temperature.
So a stir fry would be okay, but not deep fry something.
And in general, I try to say avoid deep frying, no matter what oil.
Don't want oil. You have the deep fry.
Too much water. So don't be afraid to drink water. If that means you want to put some lemon or some lime or cucumber, whatever you want to put in there to make it taste good, you can put some mint leaves. Make it however you want to make it. Just drink your water. Yeah, absolutely. Any things that you like, just drink your water. Does anyone know how much water you should drink in the day?
8 glasses.
Depending on your weight.
Yeah.
About
a gallon a day?
A gallon a day is excellent. Yeah. So you said depending on your weight. So there are really it's supposed to be half of your weight in ounces, right? So depending, but usually I just like to say 8. Unsweetened tea can also be an option. Does anyone drink tea or coffee? Okay. Does anyone add sugar in
there? I use the stevia, not the artificial sweet, okay. The stevia.
Okay, but no one does regular table sugar?
No.
What's that name? Stevia?
Stevia. It's made from a plant.
Yeah, and we'll touch on those sweeteners as well at the end. If I forget to mention it, remind me. regular sugar? That's what's going to break down into the bloodstream and cause your blood sugar to go up. So if you're getting, even if you're ordering a coffee from a drive-thru or, you know, somewhere you've stopped in somewhere and you've gotten a coffee, and they put sugar in it, be cautious, because a lot of times it's a lot of sugar. They do. The creamers, good point, especially the flavored creamers, can be very, very high in sugars. So even if you're not adding sugar per se, you're adding that flavored creamer in there, it could still have lots of sugar. So just check and see. I remember the first time I went through, I forget what place it was, but I ordered a coffee, and I don't drink any sugar in my coffee, but they put it on the side. And I'm not kidding you, I got 13 packets of sugar in one coffee. So if you did that, if all of that went into the coffee, my blood sugar would have been sky high after
drinking it. I have a question. I read somewhere about coffee and diabetics. Is it a problem for diabetics to drink coffee, or just the amount of coffee you drink?
The amount of coffee. So if you don't drink coffee, I wouldn't say go home and introduce it. But if you do drink coffee, I would say usually, I like to say 2 cups
would
be the maximum per day. I don't know if you have different guidelines on that.
Yeah, no more than 2.
Mm-hmm.
But they would be use coffee with caution if you're hypertensive.
Yes. Yes.
So it would raise it or lower
it? Raise it.
Okay.
Yeah. So be conscious with that if you're hypertensive, your high blood pressure.
Mm-hmm. Or high blood pressure.
Yeah. Hypertensive is the same thing. High blood pressure.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's what I mean. I thought you meant. I don't know why
you're thinking about the sugar, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I know. Yeah.
High blood pressure.
Yes, but that's in general. Even for someone that doesn't have high blood sugar or high blood pressure,
it tends to elevate
the blood pressure.
Okay.
Yeah. And then just making sure to drink plenty of water, because coffee does actually dehydrate you. So making sure to replenish the loss of water if you drink coffee.
You might as well eat mine.
Mm-hmm.
I think you might as well eat mine.
So reading food labels. Has anyone at least seen one of these? Does anyone read them?
I just started doing it.
Me too.
Because before this, I just pick up a junk, push it in the car. I read the receipt at the register.
So these can be very, very helpful. There's a lot of information on this, so we won't break everything down, but we'll highlight the most important parts of it. And this is a really good visual too of a food label, and it really tells you what each category is. But for tonight, we'll just talk about the most important things. The first thing you should look at is the very top of the nutrition fact, so the serving size and the serving per container. Okay, does anyone know why this is important? Great. If you don't know how much is actually in that, you can't accurately calculate how many grams of carbohydrates are in that food. So for example, this item here, I'm not sure what this one is, but there are 4 servings in this container. And let's just call it a bag of chips. We don't know, but we'll say this is for a bag of chips, right? A serving size is 1/2 cup. Okay? There are 4 servings in that whole bag of chips. Okay? So if you eat, if you're not sure and you just look here at the total carbohydrates and say, oh, 13 grams of carbohydrates, that's not too bad, I'm going to eat the whole thing. You eat the whole thing, but you need to multiply that by 4. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay. So that's where it's very important, because if you skip over that top part, you have no idea what any of this other information means to you.
So
again, we can see here the total carbohydrates in this picture is broken down into dietary fiber and sugars. Same thing here. So your total carbohydrate, is it easier to see this one or this one? Okay. So total carbohydrates, 17 grams. 3 are fiber, so 3 of the 17 are fiber, 5 of the 17 are sugar. Okay? So don't just look at the sugars and think, oh, there's only 5 grams in here. You actually need to look at the whole carbohydrate count.
So you multiply it by 5.
I'll go over that again.
So you multiply that, the 17 by 5, you're looking at the sugar.
No.
Oh.
The 17 grams is the total amount of carbohydrates for that
yes.
food. Of that 17, 5 are sugar.
Sugar, huh?
Right.
Uh-huh.
Okay. So that would be 12 grams that are not sugar.
Okay.
But really, you want to look at the total carbohydrates.
It's
17.
So right. How much, I'll call that in case you're supposed to have
we're trying to stay around that 45 grams of carbohydrates for the meal.
Yeah.
For the meal, right. Snacks are between 15 and 30 grams. So if you were having this,
17 would be good.
For a snack, if that's the only thing you're having. And again, I don't know what this food is, but
I say it's crackers. But that whole one thing, that's a good, that's 17, then you have to minus 17, and then take 17 from the 45. So make sure you do enough for that. Or the,
for the meal. So you're having lunch, say this is crackers, and you're having lunch, 17 grams of your 45 are coming from this food. So your whole lunch can be 45 grams.
Okay, so for the whole day, what if you only have one
whole
45
for
long things? I mean, that's just lunch. So 45 for each meal?
Yes.
Yeah.
Serving. So all of these numbers are based on one serving of the food. Then you have servings per container. It will tell you how many servings are in that. So if these are crackers, you can see your serving size is one cup, and there are two servings in the whole thing.
So basically, when you eat out of that, you should be eating out of the twice.
Yeah. If you eat the whole thing, you have to double the amount on here.
Double the amount on there.
Right. If you're trying to
So the amount on the actual label is set per serving. There are 3/3 servings in that. That's to say, there are 3 servings in that particular container. If you eat the 3, then you eat the equivalent of 3, whatever that is.
3 times 17.
So that's where it breaks it down here. It says there are 2 servings in this. So if we're calling this crackers, and there are 17 grams of carbohydrates per serving, and you eat the whole thing, it's actually you've eaten 2 servings, and you need to multiply that 17 times 2.
So it means literally you're actually supposed to not be eating and share that right now.
So imagine that this is your dinner plate.
Yeah.
Okay. Then imagine that there's a line cut straight down the middle. Then you split the other side in half. So now you have 3 parts to your plate. What goes in the biggest part?
Salad.
Okay. Non-starchy vegetables. Does anyone remember what those starchy vegetables are?
Potatoes, corn, and peas.
Yes, there we go. So your non-starchy vegetables should take up half of your plate. Then you have your protein, and then your grains and your starches. Okay. I really like to say whole grains here.
Just to be safe.
And they're more nutritious, so whole grains.
Yeah.
And then fruit can have its place, and your drink.
And you have to eat the food with the dinner?
You don't You don't have to. But if they're a snack, again, just monitoring and seeing how much sugar is in that fruit. And again, very important to know where your sugar already is. So if your sugar is high and you're going to sit down and have a banana, not the best idea because it's going to increase your sugar more.
Let me ask you another question. I was in a class the other day. You might have a class. They said in order to meet a digestive food, you must be chicken skin first. The fruits. They eat the fruits for the water from the fruits.
Sugar is all at once. See how it kind of sneak up?
And then
Grits.
One cup of grits, which is 31 grams.
Any kind of grits?
Yeah, they're pretty similar.
Cool.
Yeah.
What do you suggest? I think your color
is better.
It's better.
Yeah.
What you consider cream will be like along with, is that come a little bit open yet?
We have to look at which one and see on the label and look at the box rate to see how many grams of carbohydrates are per serving, because they do differ.
Is this
now? But it would be along the lines maybe of, could be closer to grits, could be closer to oatmeal, but it's right in that range. And again, a banana is always kind of surprising for some people. A half of your banana is 15 grams. So if you're having a whole banana, it's about 30 grams of carbohydrates. So it doesn't leave much room for, an English muffin or something. Have some protein with it, so that would balance it out.
So cutting up, I noticed when I buy cereal, I try to stay as close as possible to the lowest possible, sugar level. And the lowest I've found so far is 6 grams. So
that's pretty good.
That's really, really low.
That's really
low.
Yeah. What's the serving size?
The serving size?
Do you know?
I never really thought about it, but I really don't eat a big bowl of that. I just small bowl.
Right. I would be interested to know because
I possibly have maybe like a rare breakfast, like probably a little bit of salad or something like that.
And if it's 6 grams of carbohydrate, we're talking sugars or carbohydrates?
The sugar. I'll be honest with you, I didn't actually. I was only. I'm just learning how to read these labels. Like I tell you before, I just put it in the bag.
Right.
And
now you know.
So now I know.
Right.
So it's not just the sugar I should be concerned about, it's carbohydrates also.
Right. So check that and see. Because that could also, don't forget, that could be starches in there too. So the carbohydrates are broken down.
So it's only like the TV just stick to the thing. The TV just stick to wheat bran.
Yeah.
No wheat bran, like there's no nothing. It's just like one big oil god.
But it's carbohydrates. Just by
yeah.
by the nature of the food, it is carbohydrates.
But
it's so.
It breaks down slowly because it's whole wheat.
Because there's more fiber.
Right.
What's
the
special
key,
right?
We'll check the label on that.
Yeah. What I usually do is get that.
Oh, yeah.
The
wheat. I think they have a lot of sugar.
A lot of times things that are packaged and they're kind of sticking together, those tend to have lots of sugars in them. Breakfast, for some reason, breakfast items tend to be the hardest to find.
Chibi just boils up with it. Everything else is trying to kill you.
I stick the boiled egg in.
You can make quinoa.
This is what it could look like, right? You could have your eggs because there are no carbohydrates, very, very minimal carbohydrates there, if any.
You have
your eggs, right? So you can have your eggs?
Yeah.
Do you have high cholesterol?
I did, when I first was diagnosed, he told me that there was a correlation between my diagnosis of diabetes and my high cholesterol, because my cholesterol was like 372.
Oh, okay.
Hi.
Yeah, it's down to like 162 now.
Okay, okay.
I recorded way down.
Well,
sugar level,
did.
Everything
so
my cholesterol was really high. My sugar was like 480. So he told me there was a direct correlation between my high cholesterol levels and me being diagnosed with diabetes.
Yeah, and there's a lot, it happens often. You see high blood sugar and high cholesterol.
Because I when I think about it in hindsight, what you're saying lines up completely with what he really died and what was what I was doing. Because at times, but let's say 5 days out of the week, and they sound like a joke, and nobody will laugh at me. I probably eat like, this is bad. Between a Monday and Friday, eat like 2 whole sticks of salty sausage by myself.
Yes.
Wow.
So just being cautious then with your eggs. I wouldn't go crazy you're having two eggs every other morning. That should be.
Okay, I know. I just said no, I don't. But I rarely eat eggs. I eat them every other week.
Yeah, that's okay. That's okay.
Right.
If you're having more than, I would say, if you're having more than two a day, so for every day, just be cautious. But eggs are very, very nutritious as well, and they're good because they're an easy, low carbohydrate source, okay, especially for breakfast. But if you had some eggs with a piece of whole grain toast, maybe some raspberries, and this actually shows a glass of milk, and that would be, you know, a pretty, and some peanut butter, sorry.
No jam, peanut butter.
Better option. So that could be an example for you of how we can combine food groups. And again, this is 46 grams of carbohydrates, everything else.
If I had known all of this prior, I would never catch this thing.
Everything, like there. But don't forget there's a glass of milk, too. There's a glass of milk, which is 12 grams.
So what type of milk you should drink?
That's 1%
coconut milk. It really doesn't make a huge difference carbohydrate-wise. It makes a difference fat content-wise. So that's the difference there. I would tend to go on lower fat, so 1% to
the almond milk.
It's
going
to
a lot of sugar.
They have it on
some. There's pros and cons of each. And I tend to switch back and forth between cows and almond because you do get more protein and calcium from cow's milk. The almond milk has its benefits of being lower in carbohydrate. So check your labels and see. See how it fits into your diet.
Someone told me the same thing she was saying, so when I purchased the first time I used it, I was in the U.S. I purchased it. I had the little package thing we were talking about, and I forget the name of the chemical they call it.
Aspartame,
right. I was looking for it in the Fubio, the Stevia, the aspartame is what they're talking about, the causes complications, cancer, and all that other stuff.
Just delicious. And I like to just say, if you can start to just come off of all sweeteners, whether it's natural or artificial, whatever it is,
right,
the better.
I don't know about that.
No será, no será.
The closest you can get to guava is the one you pick off the tree and eat that.
Yes.
If you don't cook it.
Welcome to the club.
So really quickly, we'll just look over some more examples. This is a great way. This omelet is a
type you do it yourself. It'll be better than buying it from the shop.
Sure. If you're controlling how much sugar is going in there.
You can do it on a week.
What's that?
Any dessert.
Any dessert.
Send me a big tax.
You have control over what's going in.
Yeah.
I just did that.
If you cook it yourself.
It should be good.
I understand because someone who bakes, right? One of my relatives bakes. Mm-hmm. She has a friend. He's not diabetic or hypoglycemic But he because he's gained a lot of weight over the years, he realizes that he's taking in too much sugar. So he's trying to avoid, he likes the food, he doesn't want to change what he's eating.
Right.
But he avoids almonds, sugar, whether it's artificial or all.
Right.
So he asks us to make the cheesecake for him. But he tells us don't use sugar. So the sweetened cheesecake, she uses fruits.
Okay.
The actual fruits, the strawberries and the berries, and she without the syrup.
Right.
And she put it on top.
That's a better option. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You're
subjective.
What's a better option? Yeah.
Whenever
you have the opportunity to make it yourself, you're then in control of what you're putting
in.
Vegetables are hard unless you're having a salad with your breakfast. It's oftentimes hard to get vegetables into your breakfast. So this is a really great way in your omelet with a piece of toast.
But that meat is in there. That sound?
It's probably ham.
So you get up on it.
The protein.
It's a protein.
Right. So
you can have
it.
It's a new
oil.
It's a
lot of
saturated fat. She don't be steam almond. She mean the real almond, not that. She mean the almond come off the shoulder. That one.
That's
what
he asked.
If you were listening earlier, when Brianna talked about the meat,
saturated fat. Yeah,
you
steam almond.
You
want
to be cautious with eating that. The cereal, some of the cereals, I would say high in sugar content. Because they have a small amount of sugar in it, what I tend to do is the shredded meat.
Mm-hmm.
I mix them instead of putting a whole bowl of that. I mix the shredded meat with that.
But
you have
carbohydrates in there, just see.
Okay, to make sure it's not too much.
Yeah, and you only have to really do this once or twice until it's a lot of work the first two times you do it, but then afterwards you know your combination should be. So if you're just measure out your cereal and your milk one time, know what the carbohydrates are.
Yeah. He's really doing it by
So measure it out because you have to calculate the milk too, don't forget.
Right.
So if you're putting milk in there, you have to add that 12
ounces. Once every week
of
milk, actually, it's a couple of
let's look at some lunch options. Again, this kind of breaks it down for you, gives you a good example. Half of your plate is fruit and vegetables there. You have your broccoli and your strawberries. Then you have a quarter of your plate, your whole grain.
Brown rice.
Good stuff. Your chicken breast here. Okay. that's a good, that's good lunch.
The chicken breast almost flat as a
You gotta eat two of them, eh?
So when it comes to blood sugar, it's a protein, so it's not going to increase your blood sugar. If you have an option to go more with like a chicken breast that you know, prepare something like that, would be better than like a chicken deli meat as a cold cut. Just because of the preservatives and the sodium that can be in the cold cuts. So it's not always an option. So when we're talking about blood sugar, those are decent options. But if you have the option,
that chicken about
that would probably be about 3 to 4 ounces. But again, it's getting retraining your mind to think what you need.
It ain't reading my mind that you have to retrain your belly.
Well, and that's true too, because your belly does expand if you keep
Yeah, belly does expand, right? It expands and it stays that size.
It will go back down, but it takes longer.
Exactly.
If you have, has anyone, for example, had a really big meal before you go to bed, and then the next morning you wake up and you're starving?
Yeah.
Right.
What happened to me?
If I
have dinner like 8, 9 o'clock, and wake in the morning, it's like I starve for 2 days.
Because too, when you have those big meals, you're stretching out the stomach, and then you wake up and your belly is still expanded, but there's no food in there, and then it triggers the brain to think, I'm really hungry, when maybe you wouldn't be had you not had that big
meal.
But most of the time, when I feel like that in the morning, it's because of me gets across. I eat plenty in the night,
and
I wake up very hungry in the morning. I have to go get across, and then go get across, because it's not up.
That's how it feels.
Yeah.
So everyone's different. Yeah.
What's that?
What's this? This is going to be a salad with some cheese and crackers, and then some looks like yogurt and fruit. Yeah.
No, I'm asking what is that? That is
not blood.
It's a good example of how this is your vegetable, that's your protein, and that's your carbohydrate. Yeah.
Is there any such thing as too much vegetables?
No. Unless there are those other ones that we talked about. Mm-hmm. No, it's really hard to have too much of those. Yeah. So those are what I call the free foods.
You don't know your husband will put you in the front room. You don't know your husband will put you in the front room, but that's when you know it too much.
You might like this one better. Here's some tuna, some salad, half a plate of salad. You have some tuna salad with looks like a tablespoon of mayo. You have your, looks like bread or those crisps, and then some fruit. So again, that could be a lunch.
That's another example of lunch.
This is your vegetables, which are very low carbohydrate. Then you have your protein, no carbohydrate, and then that's your carbohydrate source. Okay. And then maybe some fruit.
I gotta give up my. I agree. How about mangoes? I gotta give up my favorite fruit. We got a 10,000 mango tree, so that means we make one mango a week. Like you say, this calls for serious and military training. That I'm gonna do I go outside. I sit on my favorite mango tree and let the mango start right there. I take a nice little pile.
I know what you mean.
So I.
I know what you mean.
Nice bowl of water, and I'm watching them one by one. And just have
I know what you mean.
And when I finish, I catch a good belch, drink a big glass of water, and I go inside. Are you watching somebody else do it?
Yeah. Just now that you know that you need to watch it,
it's a
six
summer.
So here's some vegetables. Yeah, your protein and your carbohydrate. right? So that could be a dinner.
Okay.
So that's chicken.
Chicken or turkey.
So that's yellow rice.
Let's call
brown,
it brown rice.
That's
brown rice.
Just cook, you just cook the stuff in it. But, yeah.
So, veggie rice.
It
would be the same serving size as rice, like a half a cup. The question is about quinoa. So, yeah, great option.
Salad,
some shrimp, and
looks
like some chickpeas.
Mm-hmm.
Or garbanzo beans, same thing.
Garbanzo, yeah, they taste good.
You like them?
Yeah. 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 Fresh, steam them now,
there you go.
And some falling grains.
Yeah,
yeah, some kale.
Yeah, very nutritious. That's great.
Some garlic.
Yeah.
That rolls and
tastes like meat.
That's
This one here?
Yeah,
this is
chickpeas,
or garbanzo beans that are
deep. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
The garbanzo beans, they're almost just, they just, they're a little line run through it,
like
a little line run through it.
Yeah.
It tastes like meat. Little bit of meat cut, when you stand them, they taste like meat.
And a lot of people that don't eat meat use them as a substitute.
Garbanzo beans. So you get a big one,
sometimes they have the small ones, but a lot of times it's the big
ones. Also, you have to get the big plain one, the one that doesn't have any sugar.
Good. You have